morning and happy Easter, Brooklyn Tabernacle family. We are so glad to be with you. My name is Travis Cottrell. So blessed to share this great morning with you. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's celebrate that together. What a great day. Let's sing.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb.
Yes.
Till I met you.
Come on now, let's sing. Here we go.
I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. Yeah. It was my tomb till I met you.
Here's what happened.
You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my
Good morning, everyone. This is Pastor Jim Cymbala, and happy Resurrection Sunday. It's Easter, and although we're not together, we are so happy that we can celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ today, which is something we can celebrate every day. Am I correct? I thank Travis Cottrell for singing so well. He's going to come back in a second, and then we're going to be blessed by some wonderful artistry, music, a testimony of someone who has experienced resurrection power, not church, not going to church, not Brooklyn Tabernacle, the power of Jesus Christ in her life. But let me just get some announcements out of the way. Again, we welcome you, and we want you to know whoever you are, wherever you are, you can call the church at 718-290-2000. What will happen? You will talk to an actual living person. You won't get a recording. And they can pray with you, talk to you, refer you to a pastor, help you with any questions that you might have. On the other hand, you can visit our website, brooklyntabernacle.org. And there you can learn about how to leave a prayer request, because we want to be able to pray for the things that are weighing heavy on your heart right now, especially during pandemic season. So we want you to know that by visiting the website, you can leave a prayer request. You can learn about activities happening in the church right now. We want you to know about that. And just a lot of good information. By the way, we have dropped all 30 of these episodes of the Believer series. They're all free. What is that again, in case you're new to the services here? I taped 30 10-minute segments, episodes, on the believer's life. What is it to follow Jesus? What are the problems that you run into? What are the foundational truths? So we have one on what does it mean to be a Christian, another one, the believer and his or her Bible, the believer and prayer, the believer and the Holy Spirit, the believer and the second coming of Christ. What does the Bible teach? Not opinions, truth. So you can access that. I just got off the phone with a chaplain of the second largest prison in all of Mississippi, and they are downloading that and going to make it a great study series for the inmates there who have received Christ. So it'll bless you, it'll bless everyone, I believe, I pray, I hope. So what else can I talk about? I can talk about giving. When you go to the website, you can learn how to give, and we really need your help. Right now, the offering last Sunday, Palm Sunday, was down for whatever reason, but listen, God is faithful, and we had down weeks, up weeks, miracle weeks of special offerings. So please remember on this Resurrection Sunday season not to leave Jesus Christ out of the expenditure of your monies. Remember, he honors those who give cheerfully. I want to say something about next week, April 11th. I have two blockbuster announcements, biggies, huge, ginormous announcements, praise reports. They will make you happy. And I'm going to be publicly announcing it next Sunday. And then it'll be later online for everybody to absorb and know about. So I won't have to keep mentioning. But what a blessing we have to announce. Two blessings, double blessings. When are we going to meet again? That is a very good question. I'm glad you asked that. I talk with the pastors on a weekly basis. And, you know, everything is just fluid, isn't it? Oh, there's a new strain. It's coming from Brazil. It's coming from Poland. It's coming from the South Bronx, wherever they're coming from. What to do? Do we go down now, shut down? Is there going to be a spike? We don't know. But what we're hoping to do is open ASAP with no restrictions. We're wanting to hug, pray, cry, worship, lay hands on those who are sick, shake hands, talk, without garbling our words because of a mask. That's what our hope is, that we can pray, worship God, hear the word in an open kind of format. That's the feeling of the pastor. So we're trying to get to that by studying what's happening with the virus, and then also getting directions from the powers that be, the city and the state, of what's allowable and what's not. But just know this. We want to open free and not 12-foot distancing. How would the choir sing 12-foot apart? We'd have to rent Central Park. So what we want to do is open where we can just have it normal and worship God rather than the meeting's over. Let's run out before we talk to anybody and catch the virus. So just know our hearts on that, and we'll keep you updated on that. And there'll be a statement on the website so that you'll be able to know our thoughts on that. But right now, I want to go back to that thought of giving. Could you please remember us as you give this week? Please remember us. Now, Travis Cottrell is coming back, and he's going to lead in worship, and that is going to flow right into Because He Lives. What is Because He Lives? Not the song that is often sung on Easter Sunday, but the name we've given to the presentation of music and testimony. I'll be back at the end of it. Sit back and get ready to worship. Open your heart, not just your ears and your eyes. Open your heart now to what the Lord wants to say to you. Happy Resurrection Sunday. God bless you.
Thank you, Lord. From death to life, that's our testimony today. Let's sing that.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Thank you, Lord. How can we ever thank you? Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Oh yes I do, oh yes I do. Sing that together. In Christ alone,
in Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless days.
This gift of love, darkness lay.
Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And his death is victory, since Christ has lost.
Thank you, Lord. We pour out our praise and thanksgiving. Your word tells us that we enter your gates with thanksgiving. So it's with thanksgiving we say thank you for the cross today. Thank you for the blood of Jesus, the sacrifice, our atonement, our covering. We thank you for the empty tomb, that because your son is alive and his resurrection power raised him from the dead, your resurrection power raised him from the dead, then we can rise and be alive and fully live. Thank you for life in Christ, because of Christ, through Christ, and for Christ. And we celebrate that today. The cross, the blood, the empty tomb. Jesus, we praise you. And it's in the name, that name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Happy Resurrection Sunday, Brooklyn Tabernacle. I'm Charity Gayle. This is my husband, Ryan Kennedy, and we are so blessed to be with you this Easter morning.
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. And for the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. My place laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood.
Jesus is
You brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Thank you.
I'm Cynthia Huber. My mother, my younger brother, and I moved quite frequently. My mother was extremely abusive, both verbally and physically. I ended up in foster care. My foster care experience was brutal. I looked for shelter in the lobby of a project. A man came in, asked me for a light. When I said I didn't have one, he pulled out a gun, led me to the rooftop where he raped me. I came back after this episode, told my foster carer's daughter, and she said not to tell anyone. So I didn't. I aged out. I was given some money, sent to the welfare office and told to get an apartment, not knowing or having any idea how to go about doing this with no life skills. I ended up homeless. I ended up in San Francisco, where I began my journey in the X-rated adult business as a stripper. I felt I had no choice. I felt extremely hopeless. I thought that I wouldn't even live to see 30. I ended up back in New York, where I worked in various clubs in the city. I ended up working one at a certain point at Showworld. There was one bathroom that was for us girls that had one window in one of the stalls. We would go in and smoke weed, do coke, drink, whatever, just get some daylight. And across from it was then Christian Publication Bookstore. And I used to stand there sometimes by myself and just watch people of every race, every age, going in and out, in and out. And I was drawn to this. I decide one day that I'm going to get a Bible. So I went, and a man asked me, and I said, I want a Bible. So he gives me my first Bible, NIV, leather-bound, you know, pocketbook-sized Bible, and tells me to start in the book of John. So I did. I sat in my dressing room in between sets reading the book of John. And I didn't know what was happening, but what happened was transformation. He started talking to me. I realized that he loved me. I realized who he was. I realized that he felt what I felt and he understood what I was going through. My good friend Maritza, unbeknownst to me, was a backslidden Christian. Before Easter Sunday, I asked her, could you take me to your church? At the end of the service, the pastor asked if somebody would want to come up and accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. I didn't know anything about the prayer of faith, none of that. All I knew is that once I got there, I wasn't going to leave. I actually went back to work, and church on Sunday. And it wasn't until one day, a couple of months maybe even after, I'm in Show World, and I just started crying, and I couldn't anymore. And I said to the boss, I can't do this anymore. I have to go. And he said, I know, you can go. And that was the end of it. I never looked back. My money ran out. I couldn't pay my rent and my bills. So I had to choose what to pay. So I paid off a little bit of this and a little bit of that. I was still very vulnerable and susceptible to people. But this time it was with God. And I believed him. So when I read his promises, I believed it. You didn't have to beat me over the head with it. I just, okay, I believe you, and I'm gonna take you at your word. So I didn't panic. I didn't worry, but I didn't recognize that I wasn't worrying. This is something that had been with me all my as far back as I could remember. Worry and fear, sometimes panic. But I didn't realize it yet, but I wasn't worried. I was holding strong on his word, and I was believing him to get me out of this situation. And Con Ed comes, and he's coming to turn my lights off. For some reason, the man started reprimanding me about having my lights turned off, which was very peculiar. So I said to him, well, if Jesus can live by candlelight, so can I, you know? And he just looked at me like I was insane. And that's when it hit me. Oh my goodness, this is what he's talking about when he says, I will give you the peace of God, not peace of the world. I will give you the peace that surpasses all understanding and knowledge, that will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I got it. I was actually living it. And as Jesus Christ is my witness, my phone rang, and it was the pastor's sister, and she needed a place to stay. She asked if she can be my roommate. Well, I had to tell her, well, I have no lights, my, you know, everything's about to get cut off, I'm about to be evicted. She ended up with like the straightest face. Oh, don't worry about that. I'll pay it off for you. You just pay me back as you can. And I did. And literally, as God is my witness, my clientele list started going up and up and up and up, and I started to become known for being the personal trainer of the semi-professional athletes at New York City Sports Club. It was amazing, amazing. And this is pretty much my journey. And it hasn't stopped, and it's not going to stop. I can't even fathom going back. I'm going to be Mary of Martha and Mary. I'm going to be that woman who sits at his feet and waits on him. Because I did it before, and it worked. There's only Jesus. There's only him. He has never failed once. He hasn't failed me then. He will not fail me today. He won't fail me tomorrow.
What an honor it is to be here today. Thank you so very much. Another honor is to sing about the grace and the mercy and the goodness of God. Brooklyn Tab, I love you, Pastor Jim. I love y'all so very much. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for letting me be here on Easter Sunday. No one knew how alone I was feeling, and the emptiness I tried so hard to hide. Though I laughed and said my life is fine without you, I was covering up the secret tears I cried. But then one day someone told me of your mercy and the love you showed on a hill called Calvary. There you died and purchased my redemption. When you broke sin's power, set my spirit free. I'm amazed that you love me. Tomorrow, knowing you.
Was that testimony not amazing? You know what's the best part of Cynthia's story? It's the truth. I want to talk about that for a second as we close off this Easter Resurrection Sunday service and special. I hope you enjoyed the music and especially that testimony. Jesus said to Pilate, who was the governor who could pull the trigger on his death or his release. Pilate said, "You are a king then?" And Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." Could you just listen to that again? "In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." And Pilate, you know the setting there. They had a trumped-up trial. The religious leaders were bent on destroying Jesus. They weren't interested in the truth. They had seen his miracles. They rejected the truth. It wasn't that they couldn't believe. They chose not to believe. The cost of believing in him, loss of perks and power and their own way, and they being the center of their universe, is too much. But they knew. They knew. Pilate knew. Pilate knew this is not just some thief, robber, insurrectionist. This is somebody different. He was marveling at Jesus' composure. And his wife had a bad dream the night before and sent a message to her husband. "Don't have anything to do with this innocent man. Do not mess with that man." But Pilate, we'll get to that in a second. He was in a bind, wasn't he? To side with Jesus and believe in Jesus, the cost of that. But let's get back to the truth. What Cynthia shared is true because it corresponds with reality. Truth is that which corresponds to reality. It really happened, then when you tell it, it's the truth. If it never happened and you make up the story, it's not your truth, it's false. There's truth and falsity. And we live in a day, as you know, where the truth is disappearing. Truth is dying in the streets. Because everyone has, quote, their own truth. But that, of course, is impossible. You can have your opinion. I can have my opinion. But you can't have your truth. 2 and 2 is 4. Or as I learned in that philosophy class in college many moons ago, the bug is on the rug, or the bug is not on the rug. You can't have both true at the same time. That happened to Cynthia. She lived through that. The change in her life is real. It's the truth. And of course, we live in a society where lies and false appearances are very popular and dominate the scene, don't they? You say what's convenient, you spin things. If the truth is inconvenient, you tell a lie to cover the truth that you don't want people to know. And we're all used to that. Sometimes they said upon some politicians, if their lips are moving, they're lying. Because the point is not to tell the truth, the point is to either tell people what they want to hear, that happens in churches, or what you want them to believe so you'll look better. But truth, raw, naked truth, that's hard to come by. Some people find truth intrusive. You're hurting me. That's, you know, hate speech. Well, there is hate speech, but truth is not hate speech. Truth is the truth. The world is not flat, it's round. Well, I don't know. Well, no, because it's round. They got pictures of it. So Jesus said to Pilate, and Pilate had a cavalier attitude about truth because when Jesus spoke about truth, Pilate replied, "What is truth? Like, who cares about truth? I'm into power. Other people are into pleasure. Other people are into boasting about all their accomplishments. Other people are into very ugly, dark things. But very few people are truth seekers." So that's why this sentence by Jesus, it should make us pause. He said, "The reason I was born and came into this world was to bear witness to the truth." Notice he knew that not everybody would believe in him, but he said, "Everyone who wants to know the truth, I am the way and the truth and the life," he said in another place. Everyone who wants to know the real deal about what? About everything, about life, about death, about life after death, about sin, about salvation, about love, about the reality of God. Jesus came to bear witness about the truth, of the truth, for the truth. And everyone who looks for truth will listen. Those who have made up their mind, "I don't want to know truth, I want my way. I know, but that way could hurt you." No, don't tell me that. I want my way, whatever the repercussions might be. You believe what you want to believe, I'll believe what I want to believe. I know, but can't we talk about the truth? So Jesus either is the truth or he's the biggest fraud and make-believe story in the history of the world. Wouldn't you say that? I mean, just think, 2,000 years later, a man never traveled 200 miles from where he was born, never wrote a book, never commanded an army, and yet even people who don't believe in him fulfill his prophecies when he said, "Don't use my name in vain, and people will hate me. They're going to hate you because they hated me." Did it not all come true? I mean, the followers of Jesus are persecuted. His name, you can say any other name among the media types, but not the name of Jesus. That's going to stir up a hornet's nest. Ah, Jesus is the truth. He knows the truth. So what's the truth that he came to bear witness to? Let's break this down and end it. What's the truth that Cynthia found? What's the truth about you and me and God and the universe and the meaning of life? What's the truth? What's the truth he came to bear witness to? Number one, Jesus came to bear witness to the truth that God loves you and me so much. No matter how we run from him, how we violate his commands, how we violate our conscience. You know, a lot of people, someone said to me the other day, I just don't believe in the Bible and that's God's word. And yet, if we would live the way Jesus told us to in the Gospels, what kind of world would that be today? Do unto others as you would want others to do unto you. Love one another. Be kind. Be compassionate. Don't hate. Don't be racist. Don't live immoral lives. Don't self-destruct. Don't hurt children. Don't disrespect women. I mean, if we all lived that way, what kind of world it would be? Jesus came to bear witness of the truth. And that truth that I want to first focus on is that he loves you and I despite who we are. Like Cynthia. Not many religions of this world would say, "Oh, give me Cynthia, and I'll make her a shining saint." No, it would be like, "Please, just go in the back somewhere." We want someone who's been raised and trained and has money and educated. But God loves this world so much that he's for you, he's for me. He has a plan for your life, a plan for my life, a beautiful plan for Cynthia's life, which she is now living out. So you're listening to me today. Forget going to church and Easter Sunday. God desperately loves you and I. We know that because Jesus bore witness. He, everywhere he went, other people were rejected by society. He almost like had a special love for them. He loved wealthy people. He loved poor people. He loved everyone. He loved every single person. What kind of love is that? That he showed and bore witness to, that, ladies and gentlemen, when he was on the cross, being crucified for the people that he came to save, he was praying for them as they were mocking him. Excuse me. Forget the spitting on him and the beating he took. As he's on the cross, Father, forgive them. That's the truth about God. God is looking today to forgive you and me and help you and me. Not only if we've never been Christians, but if you've been Christian, served the Lord, but now you're not in a good place. Come on, let's do real talk. Some of us are not in a good place. We're not in a good place. We're not walking with the Lord. We know about the Lord. We, you know, celebrate Easter Sunday in some way, shape, or form. But really, if you analyze our lives the way God's eyes see through everything, we're not in a good place. So you would think he would say, what? You once knew me, and now you're going to walk away? And now you're going to live that way again? And I pulled you out of that mess? No. Instead of saying, I'm going to give you a whack now that you won't soon forget, no. He says, lo, I stand at the door and I knock. I love you. His love will fight us all the way to the day we die. That's the truth that Jesus came to bear witness to. That God is love, such a love, the Bible tells us, that he gave his only begotten son, Jesus Christ. Not just to come to earth, but to die on a cross so that you and I could have our sins forgiven legally before God. Blood had to be shed. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiving of sin, putting away sin. Do you get it? Someone has to give their life. The life is in the blood. So either I'm going to be punished or Christ was punished for me. And the Bible tells us that God's love reached so deep that he sent his own son, Jesus Christ, who is God and who died on a cross and gave his life and wept over the city that would destroy him. And wept over the people that were mocking him. And the Bible tells us that even Jesus said, you don't think I could call angels right now to get out of this spot I'm in? No, no. But then how would you and I be saved? How would Cynthia have a testimony if Jesus said, no, I'm not dealing with any cross. Whammo! Punish everyone who would rebel against such a perfect life as Jesus. But then what about you? What about me? Forget Cynthia. What about me? What hope would I have? Because all have sinned. You've sinned. I've sinned. You violated your conscience. God put a conscience inside of us. Let's not even argue about the Bible. You've never violated your conscience. Where did your conscience come from? Animals don't have a conscience. You don't see lions walk up to animals they're going to kill and say, really hurts me. I killed your sister the other day. I can't sleep at night. No. What makes it so unique is this conscience. Granted, it's been dulled and darkened in a lot of people's lives because of the coarseness of their existence. But we have, and the world has, where the Bible's never been preached, there's a knowledge of right and wrong. You see a child being mauled and beat by adults or taken advantage of in some horrible way. Everyone knows that's wrong. Well, who said it's wrong? Everyone has their own opinion, their own truth. Who says that's wrong? No, we've all sinned, come short of the glory of God, violated his word. Lawless, me, violated our conscience, told lies, did things, took advantage of people, stole. I remember the first time I ever stole some money from my brother. I didn't need a Bible verse or a sermon. Ooh, my conscience roared at me. How can you take something that belongs to someone else? So that's what the truth is that Jesus bore witness to, among other things, that God loves you and I. And it's made a way for all of our sins to be forgiven and for you to experience the same resurrection life that Cynthia is living. Don't think of what she was and look at her face and feel the love that's in her heart. My goodness. Who do you think did that? I did? The Brooklyn Tabernacle? Stop. That's God's love, God's power. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the power that changed her. Not just forgave her, but changed her. And that's what's available to us today. But, Pilate was confronted with that. And that's the other truth Jesus bore witness to. You gotta make a choice. You're either for him or you're against him. No, I'm going to sit on the fence. Once in a while, I want to go to church. I try to live the best life I can. No. Jesus bears witness to this truth. The one that's not for me is against me. The one that's not against me is for me. Choose you this day who you're going to serve in the Old Testament. There's an appeal made to the people. What are you going to do? If Jesus is real, put your trust in him and follow him today. Who could love you more? If he's not, and he's a faker, and he's a liar, and all of that, hey, just don't even talk about God anymore, especially Christianity. It's all a joke. But don't live in a denial and in some zone where you're neither here or there. Be one or the other. Doesn't that make sense? Isn't that the truth? Well, Jesus confronts us with that. So Pilate had him, and he had the power over Jesus. But in a way, you see, you don't have power over Jesus. Jesus has the power over us, ultimately. That we belong to him and spend eternity in heaven, or we're sent away from God for all eternity. It's punishment for our sins that we're never forgiven. Because we rejected that one and only sacrifice. No going to church, no Catholic mass, no Protestant services. Faith, a relationship with Jesus. So let's close. Pilate's there. His wife has warned him to not mess with this man. I had a bad dream last night. Imagine, we don't know anything about any religious affiliation she had spiritually with Jesus, but God sent a warning. Pilate got it, but he's stuck. You get it? He's stuck. What if the rumor gets out? Pilate, the governor, is a follower of Jesus of Nazareth, the one they're beating and putting up on a cross. And then he's teaching, turn the other cheek. And like, what a joke. But he wanted to get rid of him because his conscience bothered him. He saw, the Bible says, that Jesus was delivered up because of jealousy. The religious leaders were jealous of him. Pilate knew he did nothing to deserve death. You know that about Jesus. He deserves nothing to be rejected. He did nothing to be rejected by you and me. What did he do? How did he hurt you or me? But just when Pilate says, I'll release this other prisoner, the crowd, they're whack. They start yelling, no, crucify Jesus. Release Barabbas, this criminal, this murderer. Now Pilate's really in the soup. What do I do? The crowd is saying, crucify him, but I know he doesn't. He even said to them, what has he done? But see, they weren't interested in truth. They were interested in hate, passion, stirred up by others. No, crucify him, crucify him. And Pilate had to make a choice. Like you have to make a choice. I have to make a choice. What else is life but the result of our choices? Cynthia, she made a choice. What do you think? What do you think about her choice? She chose Jesus. And look what God did in her life. Would you do that today? Would you put your trust in him? Get out of the middle ground. Get out of being religious. Oh, I'm spiritual in my own way. No. Don't do that. That's a bad road. Face Jesus today. What are you going to do with him? You know, that's how I got converted. Then we'll pray. Ever tell you how I got converted? I heard a song when I was, I don't know how old, 12, 13. And it stuck with me. I had never put my faith in Jesus. And the song, old song they used to sing in churches, came to my mind while I'm laying in bed in Parkside Avenue, 384, between Bedford and Foppish in good old Brooklyn. And I'm sleeping in a bed next to my brother, a pullout. My sister's in the same room, little railroad apartment. I'm laying in bed at night, and the words of that song, ooh, what will you do with Jesus? Neutral? You cannot be. One day, your heart will be asking, what will he do with me? Listen again. What will you do with Jesus? Neutral? You cannot be. You're going to trust him or reject him. Be a Christian or reject Christianity. Neutral, you cannot be. But one day, your soul, your heart will be asking, what will he do with me? Because it's appointed for all of us to die. You're going to die. I don't know your name. I don't know where you're from. But I know one thing. I could take it to the bank. One day you will die. And me. And then the question won't be, what do your peers think? What does society think? Who had their truth? What opinion? Now you're going to be real front and center before God, before Christ. And he says, everyone who confesses my name on earth, I will confess their name in heaven. They will enter into their reward. Will it be hard to be a Christian sometimes? Yes. I'm not telling you any different. But there's a joy and a peace that Cynthia radiated. That you know, look at the blessing she has. So what's it going to be today? I love you. God loves you. I don't even know who you are, but there's such a love in my heart. I was up most of last night knowing I would speak about this and just praying, God, how can I tell them better that you love them and that you want them? Wait a minute. Don't you hear the knock? That's his knock on the door of your heart, my heart. And what does he say? Just get up and open the door. He'll take care of everything else. No, don't promise. Don't try to be better. Nothing. Just get up, open the door of your heart, and trust him. Say, Jesus, come into my life. Into my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today. Come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Can I pray with you? Let you bow our heads together. For those of you listening who are not walking with the Lord, trusting the Lord, Christ is not the center of your life. Let me put it that way. You don't have a living relationship with Christ. I want you to pray this prayer with me. I'm going to pray it real slow. Dear God, we thank you for loving us, for loving me, for loving my friends watching this. Come into my heart. Come into our hearts. We hear you knocking. There's a little burning in our hearts. Our conscience is speaking to us. The power of your word has affected us. Come into our hearts today and save and change and cleanse and make new and heal and restore and wrap that one in your arms who's hanging by a thread right now. We come against all thoughts of suicide and heavy discouragement that makes us want not even to wake up in the morning. We know the enemy has come in like a flood, but you're going to raise up a standard in the name of Jesus Christ. So we confess our sins. No excuses. The truth is that we have sinned. Have mercy on us. But oh, we are so happy we can trust you, Jesus, as our Savior. You will save me. I will not save myself. You will save me and keep me and forgive me. Bless these words that I've spoken today. keep your eyes closed. I've asked for some music to be playing here at the end. And even though I might sign off here, I think there's a good time for contemplation. What we don't want is another Easter Sunday. Went to church virtually, saw it, and all that great music. What it is you gotta have communion with Jesus. Talk to him. Then listen for him. Just wait there as long as you want. The music will play. I just thank you for tuning in and watching today. May God bless you and give you the most beautiful day you've ever had as you walk with Jesus. Amen. Stay right where you are if you'd like.